Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the opening concert of the Harmonic Series. Somehow the pleasure and the honor of opening this series has fallen to me. I suppose that has something to do with the fact that I've been helping out the Executive Director, Cindy Lawrence, of the National Museum of Mathematics, and the Associate Director, Tim Nissen. Since the museum was conceived some 7 years ago. And I will say, of all the programs that we have done, this is perhaps the longest in gestation and anticipation. So it is a particular delight to be here this evening. And to put a program like this together, I think it takes three things, which all happen to start with W, the letter of the evening. First, the will. And the will has been there from the very beginning because of how closely tied music and mathematics have been from the very roots of the Western system of music with the Pythagoreans literally millennia ago. And then we needed the way, and that came with the museum getting to know Bruce Adolphe, about whom you'll hear more in a moment. And finally, and this was the for some time the sticking point, we needed the wherewithal, again, to our great delight, recently, through the generosity of Deborah and Dexter Semt and Winton Capital Management, we finally had all of the pieces in place to begin the Harmonic Series. And please, if you could join me in thanking our sponsors. Okay, so two announcements before we actually begin. First is, and this is the first time I've gotten to say this at a MoMath event, please make sure that your cell phones are on silent. And second, tonight is the last night to purchase the subscription to the series for the subscription price. If you enjoy what you hear tonight, you may buy a subscription on your way out with Carolyn, who's the manager of our shop, and you will get the price for tonight's concert credited to your subscription price. So hopefully some of you will be interested in doing that. If not, tickets for the individual performances will all go on sale at harmonic.momath.org tomorrow, and you can buy any of the future three performances and save the card in your program that has the description of those performances. Okay, so it's now my pleasure to introduce to you Bruce Adolphe, the host of the Harmonic Series. And we first got to know Bruce because he is a composer who composed the music for the opening ceremony of the National Museum of Mathematics back on 12-12-12. And he is also the piano puzzler on NPR. And he is the former instructor at the Juilliard School of both of tonight's guests. May I present Bruce Adolphe.
Thank you, Brian. Good evening. I was thinking as you made that announcement, for a series on math and music, maybe host is not the right word, maybe constant. Because I'm going to be here for all of the shows. So, and as the constant of the Harmonic Series, I'm going to introduce you right now to two people to whom I am very partial. That's my last math joke for the evening. I'll say it again, let's get it out. Very partial. That's for the cameras, we can edit, I understand. All right, so we have two wonderful guests, two, as Glenn mentioned, two people who I had the great fortune to have as students at the Juilliard Pre-College a very long time ago. When they were kids, before they were out of high school. And now, as you probably know, they have done quite a bit. We have a man that I will describe as the living nexus of math and music, Noam Elkins. Noam is a professor at Harvard, and he's been a professor at Harvard since he was in his 20s. One of the youngest ever, maybe the youngest, probably. And a very famous mathematician who also writes music and does chess and all those great things. And also, our other guest is Orly Shaham, one of the most beautifully articulate pianists I know, and a tremendously artistic and profound reader of both standard repertoire and new music. So please welcome Noam Elkins and Orly Shaham. We're going to talk talk just for a moment, and then we're going to get into this show. We discovered that we have lots of things in common backstage, which isn't surprising.
Common denominators?
Yes. Common. You want to share a mic there? Yeah, and that one may need to be turned on, which I know is very difficult for a Harvard professor to figure out. He's got it. It's on. Okay, excellent. And I think just to get right into it, Noam has a piece which has to do with Steve Reich. You want to say a word about the clapping music, and then we'll talk about numbers and how it affects music a little bit?
Well, you have a standard introduction to this piece.
Oh, well, I do, you know, but my standard introduction to this piece is normally geared towards 3 to 6-year-olds. So if you will all bear with me for a moment.
But I just want to say the piece we're talking about is Clapping Music by Steve Reich. And the reason we're discussing this is that Noam has written a piano piece which uses the Steve Reich piece to generate his music. So it's kind of clapping becoming pitch oriented.
What's great about clapping music and the way that it's put together is Steve Reich's one of the first attempts at phasing and how phasing works. And the basic premise is you have a certain set of sounds, and I'm going to need two hands for this. You have a certain set of sounds, and if you were to then play them at the same time with your other hand, then they would just line up, and you would have that set of sounds coming from two different sources. And what happens is that the second set of sounds slowly shifts, so that then you hear the complete version like this, like this, like this, like this, keep going, until eventually it ends up here. And since this one is constantly repeating block after block after block, by the time you get to here, the two are in phase with each other. At the very beginning, you're also in phase with each other, but as you go, you're out of phase, and various different cool things happen when you do that.
And actually, I feel like that almost every day. So, Noam, you want to say anything about this piece before we get into it?
Oh, I thought we were going to actually tell you what the rhythm is. It's derived from a popular African game, which Steve Reich picked up on his travels there, and it's a very simple rhythm. It's three. Please.
No, I mean, put the mic on there. No.
So it's something like 3, 2, 1, 2.
So the reason it works well for the preschoolers when I do my kids' show is that it's you can all count to three, right? So it's 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 1, 2. Did you want to do a little musical test
I think before we ask the audience to try this, and by the way, I just want to tell you, if you can't do it, just look at the person next to you like they can't do it. It always works. So, before, I'd like to give you a short musical test to see if you're revved up. It's not an IQ test, it's just a quick music recognition test.
MQ test.
MQ, right. So, the first question is, what do you think this is?
Fairlease.
Okay, we had two kinds of answers. Fairlease, which was taking a slight risk, and half steps, which was taking no risk whatsoever. But the answer is this. What's this? Toreador song. You've got to be on your toes here. Okay, next is a test that I know Noam got right from earlier today. What piece is this? An actual piece?
Rachmaninoff.
Goldberg variations.
Yes. Who said that? Okay, and you said it with, you were totally sure, right? Yes, yes, your Goldberg variations. You also got it earlier. I'm sure you would have because I know you. But it's one of those things. Now, if you didn't get Goldberg variations, it's just the first note of the aria. But if you play the piano, then you know that this spacing is the Goldberg variations. What is this?
Moonlight.
Moonlight Sonata. This is a great audience. Now, if you're not getting that, don't worry. Just be excited about who's here. Okay, I think it's time to try the clapping. Let's do some clapping.
Okay, so here's the shtick. I'm going to do it without a mic because we need hands. Imagine that we have four little signs here. One that says 1, 2, 3. One that says 1, 2. One that says 1. And another that says 1, 2. So 1, 2, 3. 1, 2. 1, 1, 2. Let's practice bit by bit. Here's 1, 2, 3. I'll do it, and then you do it. So close. One more time. Nailed it. That one's hard. So, our imaginary signs. That was great. So now that you have that down, we can perform clapping music. And we're going to do only a very small bit of clapping music because Noam actually has some cool things that go even beyond that. But if you can get that rhythm and keep it steadily, I'm going to try to phase against you. And we're going to do the abridged version. So for anybody who knows the piece, we're just doing a few rounds. So here, I'm going to start you off and you keep going. And maybe you can keep going on the stable rhythm with
that.
Oh, for my change, yeah. So we start with a stable rhythm.
Hey, give yourself a hand.
If anybody who knows Steve Reich is here, I apologize for all the cuts made in that piece.
Okay, now Noam is going to take over and introduce his piece, which is based on death.
Okay, and so the clapping music is like 144 bars of death, 12 times 12, but there is no notes. It's all clapping, like in the original African game, and I thought, wouldn't it be nice, I mean, after the clap, it's a kind of canon, right? You know what a canon is. We have the same notes being sung, the same tune being sung by two different people, but it didn't start at the same time. So here's the same kind of thing, except with clapping. So I thought, well, this is a kind of canon, except I need to add notes to it to make it an actual canon. So that's what's going to happen. So there's going to be a tune. Going to be first heard with both hands together, and then some version of it will be heard with the hands separated by one beat, and then two beats, three, and so forth. And eventually, it's a 12-note pattern, so it comes back where it started.
The mic is on.
Yes, it is.
It's a little closer.
So it's 12-beat pattern, so it comes back where it started. Except that instead of it being a regular pattern where we just do the same thing over and over again, that would be if I just wrote. It actually changes, as you heard when I was doing this for real. So there's a bit of a puzzle here, because when I come back, it really will be together again. So maybe you can figure out how that happens. The title of the piece, by the way, is No Clapping Till the Music Starts.
Thank you.
I have two questions. Yes, number one, the glissando, that was a free moment. There was no math behind the glissando, was there?
There was no math behind the glissando. There was no math behind the one time that I went out of the female, out of the out of the white noise scale. Yeah. And there is, you know, various, you know, it's not all mathematics, because if it were all mathematics, there wouldn't be any point in writing it for music.
Yes, exactly. That was sort of my question. But I have another question, which I know you could answer for 2 hours, so I'm going to ask you to keep it to 30 seconds. Given the parameters of that clapping music, and
right,
deciding to write a piece based on that clapping music, and perhaps deciding that it will be tonal, how many different pieces could be written that would be the same but different?
I wonder why you're asking me that. The next piece actually has a bearing on this, which I imagine is why you're asking me this in the first place.
Yeah.
It's called Steganographic Etude. I mean, if there are people here recognize from one note, there are probably people here who know what the word steganographic is. For the rest, just enjoy it as a piece of, you know, something that sounds like, you know, Carl Maria von Weber or one of Chopin's other lesser contemporaries, and then I'll tell you what's going on.
Okay, but before you play it, I just want to not tell them what's going on, but just want to make sure that you understand you will find out what this piece is. And if you don't know, I see at least 3 or 4 people who are under 10. So if you're not sure what steganographic means, when you're 11, you'll find out. I mean, Noam is going to explain all of this, and even my question, which he didn't answer, I think will be part of this piece after he plays. So the idea is, while you're listening to this, aside from enjoying it, if you can possibly torment yourself as to what he's doing, that would be fun too. After you hear a piece, someone just played and tells you what it was. But here we are.
So I wrote most of that, but I didn't have a choice in every fourth note that I played in the right hand. And the notes that matter, oh, I don't know, is there a focusing thing here or there's a zoom? Let's see if we can zoom on this. Don't worry if you can't read music notation. Music notation is basically a graph of pitch against time, but you don't even need to know that. This is the only way I can remember more than a handful of digits of pi.
Say that again.
This is the only way I know how to remember more than a handful of digits of pi. Right? So pi starts 3.14159265, etc. And most musicians, unless they've been indoctrinated by Babbitt, when they hear 3.14159, if they want to convert into notes, they do this. Because first note, second, third, fourth, fifth, etc., up to the ninth. Then when eventually you need the zero, you go 2, 1, 0, the note below one. And so we have these 10 notes, and you can make, you know, pi is basically random numbers, so it's random music. Nobody wants to hear 3 minutes of random music. Nobody can remember 3 minutes of random music. But it turns out that when we memorize things, we put them inside a context that we can remember. We tell a story that weaves around them, and so I'm telling a musical story here. Every fourth note, tom, ti, ra, dum, one, tom, pa, pum, four, one, five, nine, two, six, five, and so forth, and so. And so there are 240 bars, excuse me, there are 60 bars in this piece, 240 quarters, and every new quarter gives me new digits, and so I can, going through the piece in my mind, I can actually, you know, I can actually remember the first 240 digits. Meanwhile, you know, I think it sounds like a, you know, reasonably convincing piece of music, and there's therefore, you know, about 10 to the power, 240 at least, other such pieces of music, because, as I said, pi's random number, they could have used any number for that.
My other question then is, do you think anybody uses the digits of pi to remember the piece that you wrote?
There aren't that many other people I know who remember it to begin with. I don't know how many of them have the first 240 digits memorized. I suspect it won't be of much use as you're in the throes of learning the piece. Steganographic, by the way, means it's from... All the six-year-olds here know at least one word that begins with stega something, right? Stegosaurus, the dinosaur, it's called Stegosaurus because it was hidden. Steganographic is hidden writing. It's secret writing that's so secret you can't even tell there is a hidden code. And presumably, if this just sounds like music to you, you wouldn't have thought to see what's the hidden code under it, but in fact, there is, you know, every fourth note, if you look at it in the right way, it's just, you know, encoding digits of pi. We could have encoded also, you know, come meet me at the Birch Tree at 3:50 or whatever. Anyhow, so that's the steganographic music. I've been here for a bit too long, so probably it's a bit time for only to...
Well, I was just going to say, you could also encode things like "I love you, Clara."
Yes.
If you wish you want.
Which is just a little segue.
Yes.
Into the world of
Brahms, of course. Brahms.
Romantic music.
Well, I think we can celebrate a little birthday first.
Yeah. We're going to do a birthday celebration for...
It's, you know, zero more shopping days until Beethoven's birthday.
Today is Beethoven's birthday. And we just thought, you know, this is a concert. We need to do something about Beethoven. Yeah. So Orly is actually going to play... I don't know why I said actually. I'll be thinking about that later. Orly's going to play one of Beethoven's bagatelles from Opus 126.
It's number 3, actually.
Number 3 from Opus 126.
For whoever's keeping count out there.
And I'll just say about bagatelles, you know, we think of the word bagatelle meaning a trifle. But with Beethoven, these are like short diary entries. They're very personal and quite profound. And this small piece, which is also in some ways very simple, has, and maybe this we can discuss later, a kind of strange complexity, because harmonically it's extremely simple. But the way he uses the keyboard, the way he uses register, the way he displaces octaves, and the way he introduces chromatic notes that are not in the key, in a very simple way, but very methodical, at the same time is extremely emotionally profound. Extraordinary piece. Are you ready to play this?
I think one other thing I want to add before that, since we were just sort of listening to a piece where there was a message kind of encoded within the piece, I think that's, in its own way, that's true of most music.
All music, maybe.
And in particular, in this piece, the thing to listen for, I think, which is fairly easy to hear on first hearing, is that the theme keeps coming back in completely different ways. So you may lose it, for a moment and say, well, I don't know what happened to that tune that I heard at the very beginning, but it always somehow reappears, and it's always maybe in a different voice, maybe it's a little higher, a little lower, maybe it's suddenly off displaced off the beats, so you're not actually hearing it in this exactly the same rhythm you were hearing before. But that idea of encoding messages into the music, I think is pretty much universal.
Listening very carefully, the end of that piece has the pedal down quite a lot, and Beethoven is renowned for leaving the pedal down in certain pieces. There are quite a few there where he, of course the piano was different in those days, but still, a wash of color, a wash of sound, which gives it a very dreamy-like quality way before Debussy or anybody thought of this kind of thing. Did you want to add anything?
I think there's something there, since we're speaking in mathematical terms, I think there's something there about overtones. The harmonic series is sort of the perfect place to have this discussion. You know, I think he was really playing with how the piano rings, and in more specifically, years before he wrote this Bagatelle, he made a diary entry in which he said, you know, let your deafness no longer be a secret, even in art. And he sort of pledged to share his difficulties in hearing through his music. And I think in many ways, his use of the pedal later on, the idea of keeping it down, caused certain things to ring on the instrument that were the same things that he was hearing in his ear. Because of course his deafness was not necessarily an absence of sound, it was a tinnitus, it was extra noises that accompanied things. So I think he was kind of giving us a clue into his world. If you think about it, the only reason we hear the music the way we do is because of the shape of our ear. The overtones that are out there, many of them are completely beyond us, and we can't even hear them with our apparatus, but he could.
Very nice, yes. Now, is the next piece my inner Brahms?
It is.
Okay, so the next piece Aurelie's going to play, I will ask you to say a word about it, and then I will do some analytical discussion of it, and then you can play it.
So, my word. I just recently finished a really big, a long project. It took a few years of immersing myself in the world of the late piano music of Johannes Brahms. And one of the reasons that I love this space is because Brahms seemed to just kind of take everything in, everything that was going on musically before him and up to him, and at the same time be completely forward-looking in what he was doing. It's that old question, you know, was Brahms a historicist or was he a progressive? And I think, you know, he was a shoe polish and a floor wax. There's no reason he can't be both. So one of the things that I undertook with this project was to actually commission a few composers to be inspired by Brahms. And Bruce was the first composer I approached. I knew that I would want him to be part of this, partly because I had been a student in his theory class. And so I think my own understanding of Brahms and how Brahms puts together notes came very much from that class and from pieces we studied, you know, where I still have the markings in my score of the harmonic analysis we did in that class, where I couldn't believe the speed with which some of my colleagues identified Neapolitans. But what Bruce was able to capture with this piece is not only the sort of the spirit and the feeling, and actually a lot of very specific allusions to Brahms' style, but also a great deal of the craftsmanship of Brahms, the way that he chooses to put notes together, the kinds of techniques that he uses as a composer in order to affect the kind of sounds that he wants. And it does give very much like that Beethoven Bagatelle I just played, it gives this feeling as things spread through the different registers of the piano, it gives a feeling of a completeness and very orchestral sound to the instrument.
Well, that's exactly what I was going to say. Now,
thank you,
really. Before I go to the piano and just say a few things about the piece, I don't know if you're the kind of person who reads reviews, and over the years, there have been a lot of reviews in the past and even now, in which mathematics is used to mean bad. This is very common. And I'm going to read you a review of Brahms' music from 1900, with, I don't think any commentary will be necessary. But it was written by Vernon Blackburn in the Pall Mall Gazette of London, February 28, 1900. The Brahms Sextet is a work built upon dry as dust elements. It is one of those odd compositions which at times slip from the pen of Brahms, apparently in order to prove how excellent a mathematician he might have become. But how prosaic, how hopeless, how unfeeling, how unemotional, how arid a musician he really was. You feel an undercurrent of surds. Those are a quantity not capable of being expressed in rational numbers. Of quadratic equations, of hyperbolic curves, of the dynamics of a particle. Terrible. But it must not be forgotten that music is not only a science, it is also an art. The sextet was played with precision, and that is the only way in which you can work out a problem in musical trigonometry. Okay. Sorry? I don't know which sextet it was, but I don't know if that matters too much. But anyway, I'll check into that. Now, that's your piece. That's okay. Brahms also said something very interesting that helped me write this piece, which is, I don't know if my music is beautiful, but I know it is unassailable. Now by unassailable, he meant that he knew why every note was there. He knew exactly what he was doing. Now some composers would say they never know why every note is there. They don't want to know that. And this business of math and music is interesting in this regard because how conscious are these decisions? But another way of looking at it is not how conscious is it, but how verbal is it, or how numerical, or how much is it pure sound? So I think composers work in different ways. And I know for me, writing this piece, I was aware of some of Brahms' techniques, so I had those kind of in a conscious level. But I wanted the piece to be emotionally connected to my feelings in their life, and that tends to be an unconscious thing. And I wanted it to be unassailable, because Brahms was unassailable. So therefore, I had to have some thoughts Now, for example, Noam's pieces were unassailable because we know exactly what they were doing, and except for your glissando, which I want to talk to you about, it's really, you're not my student anymore, I know, but that glissando, really, I don't know. But that's a moment of complete fantasy and freedom, which can be defended only in the courtroom, I think. But anyway, so what I decided to do is create a series of cadences. I'm not going to go through the whole piece. I'm just going to give you a few ideas of what kind of structures appear. And they are symmetrical, and they are related in a series of parallelisms. And I'm going to try to explain it at the keyboard, and then orally we'll play. Are you ready? Oh. That's so loud. Yeah, this is pretty loud. There will be a series of cadences throughout the piece that are all based on ninth chords. Now, ninth chord, this is a minor ninth chord. Here's the whole chord. But I never play, well, I shouldn't say quite never, but in all these cadences that matter, you will only hear, and never in that order. And all of the important cadences take that structure and revolve around one note. So the note F. Maybe. Thank you. That's why I invite my students. Although it's been a while. The note F, if it's the third of a chord, will sound like this. If it's the root of the chord, if it's the ninth of that chord. And as these cadences appear, the previous cadence is used in a high kind of resonance in the background. So for example, this is the first one. The second one, with the first one up here. And then the third one, F, is the fifth of the chord. It was the third, it was the ninth, now it's the fifth. Here it is as the ninth, and here it is as the third. And then in the final cadence, you have them all, the root. So the structure of the piece moves through a cycling of keys that relates to that. And there, I could say a lot more about it, but I'm beginning to think that's almost enough. Another thing would be that there are two dominant relationships. If you know music, dominant has nothing to do with what it means in the rest of the world. It just means five up. Okay, so for example, so five up from this would be on C. And five up from F sharp minor, which I haven't mentioned and I will in a moment, would be this. So those two appear also, and the reason for the F sharp minor is the piece goes back and forth as if it's undecided between F bass music and F sharp bass music, starting right at the very beginning. So that if you understood all of that, great. If you got a feeling that you understood it, that's actually pretty good too. Because if you know Antonio Damasio's books, The Feeling of What Happens, neurologically speaking, maybe you did understand it, and you'll figure it out later, wake up in the middle of the night and say, aha, don't call me.
Thank you.
And now we're moving on to something that I think would be fun to talk about after we hear some of it, which is some music by Arnold Schoenberg that is not 12-tone music. And if you know the works of Schoenberg, you probably know that he went through a period of writing music that was not tonal, but it wasn't yet systematized. He went through a period of experimentation. And in that period, he really was writing something kind of unique in the history of music, which is there's really nobody else who just wrote music that was purely by ear without a system. There was no tonality, there was no mode, there was no substitute for tonality, there was no new system of mathematical writing, there was nothing. Now, of course, many people write like that now, but that's beside the point. At the time, it was a very strange thing, a kind of an expressionist moment in music, but we'll talk about, after we hear some of these, we'll talk about what it means to write without a system, and even if that's possible, okay? What do you want to do? You want to play them all? Sure.
So the suite, this is Schoenberg's Opus 19, and it's a suite of six pieces. And I think the only thing that I want to say before we talk about them is that it is a suite of six pieces, and that's not an unprecedented thing in music. In fact, it goes going way back to the Baroque, six was sort of the auspicious number for a suite. And there's a kind of emotional affect, there's a kind of emotional trajectory to what happens in the course of a six-movement work that I think Schoenberg is very much tapping into with this, even though each one of the pieces here is maybe 30 seconds long. So I guess what I'm trying to say is if you hate one of them, it'll be over in the book.
Thank you.
before we do one more piece, which is quite different, I'd like to talk about this for a moment, if you don't mind. Noam, I'm curious, do you think it's possible, given that we're using 12 half steps and certain limitations of what's available on the piano, to write a piece that has either no system or is perhaps not possible to be analyzed? Is that possible?
You probably don't want me to go too far in the direction of Kolmogorov complexity and all that. There is a mathematical notion for measuring precisely, you know, how much information, a piece of music, but it can be any text has, and, you know, if it has too much information, we usually can't make any sense. But it has too little information, well, we're back to Marvin Minsky's quip that in classical music, the magic number is 3. You do something 3 times, you do it all, and then you do something else, and in pop music, the magic number is 64. There's too little information.
But how many chords? 3 chords for some... Right. They used to say there would be 500 people coming to hear 3 chords and 3 people coming to hear 500 chords.
Well, you know...
That's a good joke.
We all know the exceptions of, you know, the piece by Chopin and Schubert that have 1.5 chords.
Right. A little demonstration.
The Lyre Mon, yeah, it's a special effect at the end of this, you know, huge journey where the person making the journey away from love to cold, basically, you know, finally encounters another human being and it's this organ grinder that keeps, you know, grinding the same thing over and over again. It's an amazing way of representing this, but it's not the only thing in the piece, of course.
Right. But let's get back to this.
But sorry, yeah.
In Schubert, here he's, in a way, the way he wrote that music is by avoiding certain things, right? He's avoiding tonality.
He's avoiding some things, but I mean, it's not like it's without pattern. I mean, it's music in 2-4 time and 3-8 time. You have... Okay, so this is avoiding rhythm, but he's establishing the tonality, even though he's not calling it that.
Well, he's establishing, to be fair, a kind of point of reference,
yeah,
which is tonal light, but it's not in a key, obviously. So let's say, instead of saying he's avoiding tonality, we could say he's avoiding key and harmonies that would delineate the hierarchy of a key.
Yeah.
So by continually avoiding all of that, do you think one stumbles upon a system? How inevitable was that 12-tone system? No, I have no idea I was going to answer this question.
Spanish Inquisition?
What?
The Spanish Inquisition?
The Spanish Inquisition.
Well, okay. It was probably inevitable that somebody would try it. I mean, Schoenberg wasn't even the only one. There was a fair bit of Hauer doing things like that. What is harder to explain is probably some accident of history in, you know, the culture, is that it stuck around for so long.
Yeah.
I mean, so... Basically, the idea was they're trying to purposefully, you know, treat all notes equally, avoid there being any kind of hierarchy by just declaring we're going to take 12 notes, put them in, you know, some order that hopefully sounds reasonably random, so it's not just, that's a 12-tone row, but, you know, no self-respecting 12-note composer would write it, would use it, or... That you can actually find in Mozart, maybe upside down, but...
You can find it in Bach, too, which fugue is it, the B minor fugue?
You mean this?
Yes.
That's a 12-tone note, repeat notes and everything.
Sorry?
That's not even the proper 12-tone note, repeat notes and everything.
Well, it's not the row, but it gets all 12 pitches within the subject.
Oh, yeah, you can find an actual 12-tone row in Bach, but that's a different conversation, but the point is, it's the way it's being treated. You know, you make the whole piece out of this row, you make sure that you don't repeat an order until you've already heard all the other
Yes, however, works with my car, too, because I don't sure have a car. But let's bear in mind that this piece that we just heard is not 12-tone. It has no system whatsoever.
Yeah. I think one of the interesting things that we keep coming back to, and as we've been discussing backstage as well, although we haven't said it explicitly, it's that balance that music has between some kind of system which is quite strict in its rules and the ability to touch us emotionally. And there are a certain subset of people who can look at a beautiful mathematical equation and experience that same feeling, but I think the subset is maybe larger for people who can listen to a piece of music and have that feeling of connectedness and of beauty. And perhaps that's just a question of training and what you've been trained to be able to see. But that balance is something that all of these composers we've been talking about, including you, struggle with all the time and shift between all the time. I mean, you know, Bruce touched upon it in his piece a little bit, but there's so many more systems happening in that piece, and yet the end result is a piece of emotional import and emotional content that is able to be transmitted to us, whether or not we're aware of any of the systems behind it.
Yeah, and in fact, I feel like I need to tell a Native American story right now.
Which story?
A Native American story.
Coyote? Or
you don't want to hear it? You'll enjoy it.
No, I'm putting my mic away so I can hear it.
Oh, okay.
One of us is free to die in that.
Okay. If we want feedback, we'll ask for it. So basically, this story has a lot to do with what we've just been talking about. It's a Hopi story. I think it's also told by Tewai Indians and some other Indian people, but it takes place before there were stars in the sky. And the great-grandmother spirit comes to first man and says, here is a jar of stars. Please take these stars and this book. The book has exact places and charts, graphs, everything. It tells you exactly where the stars must go. And I want you to follow everything in this book and do it by the book. So first man takes this book and the stars in a jar, and he starts to place them in the sky, checking the book very carefully. It takes a very long time, you might imagine, to do this. While he's doing it, along comes Coyote. Now, Coyote is that crazy wild dog, you know, from the cartoons. Well, it actually goes back a lot further to Native American stories. And the coyote says, what are you doing? And first man says, Coyote, be quiet. I am putting stars in the sky exactly the way they're supposed to go according to these charts and graphs. And Coyote says, that's ridiculous. Give me that jar of stars. I'm just going to throw them up there any way I want. It's going to look fantastic. So they wrestle back and forth with the jar, and then finally the coyote wins and gets the jar of stars and throws them up there, and they're sticking all over the place. And first man says, Coyote, stop it, you're creating chaos. And Coyote says, you call it chaos, I call it beauty. And to this, do you like that? Okay. And to this day, if you look, or I should say to this night, if you look up at the sky, you will see the chaos and the order, except, is that true? Isn't it our perception and our determinations of chaos and order? And we know, I'm sure you all know the answer to that, but in other words, there's all kinds of designs and patterns that have gone culturally, gone on to be described in the sky. But that's a matter of order perceived rather than order that's actually there. Okay, now we have one more. Oh, you like that? That's so nice. Thank you. See if I, yes, no.
Here I thought the punchline is going to be a coyote, you know, threw them out up in the sky wherever they go, and they end up exactly where the chart is.
That's another good story. That's a good footnote. They end up exactly where the chart says. See, the other trick is to, after they're up there, you make a chart that makes it look like they were in the right place.
That's how I passed all my math classes.
Okay, and we're going to end. And then there's a big reception, I believe, where we can all get to know each other, you know, all things being equal, fairly well. As was mentioned by Glenn at the beginning, I have a radio show now, it's all going on, it'll be 15 years next year, where I play piano puzzlers, which are little things I write where I take familiar tunes and also familiar pieces of music or styles and mash them together. And create something for people to guess. It's like a game show. So Orally, he's going to play one of them for us. I'm not going to tell you what it is, and you can raise your hands. You have to get two things. There are, well, this will be obvious. There are two things to figure out. About your question and make sure it's good. So that if somebody else has a really good one and you ask a not so good one, you're not ruining their evening.
So Bruce will pick someone and I will bring the mic.
Well, the very first hand that went up is right there.
To what extent did composers over time compose their music with a conscious appreciation of the mathematics behind it as opposed to an intuitive one on the way to doing it? And did that evolve or develop over cultural time? And does it today?
It's a great question. I have some answers. Do you want to each take a turn at it? No? You want to go first?
It varies by composer, and you can never, I mean, once it's, you know, a work of art, you can always find things in it, Mathematica and otherwise, that you didn't know about before. You know, that's sort of what part of what music theory does. It accounts for music of the past, and it gives us, you know, ideas for what the parameters are for what future music can be, and mathematics is part of it. I mean, I'm not sure that it's just mathematics. Composers used to be a lot more concerned about certain things that are mathematical than they are now, you know, the specifics of just what the tuning system is, you know, the well-tempered of the well-tempered clavier, for example. By the way, the whole harmonic series upon here, when you play a note, let's say one that's about 100 cycles per second, even though it might sound like it, you're playing also the one that's 200, 300, 400, 5, 6, and you hear those make a nice harmonic sound. This is the wavelength of these four mathematical harmonic series, 1, half, 3, 4, 5, etc. And the piano actually can do some arithmetic. It can find greatest common divisor, least common multiple. So if this was a 200 and a 300, it can find 600 by holding one of these notes down without playing it and hitting the other, and out emerges 600 because the first note is harmonic with both of them. And some composers actually use that device in their music. But a lot of it's intuitive. I mean, even the part that that was called unassailable, and, you know, certainly in my music, possibly even in Brahms's, there are choices made there, there are artistic, you know, and emotional choices that go outside of the you know, even Beethoven fifth, the famous oboe solo, sure, it's there, you can find some reason for it post facto, but you have to be Beethoven to find it. Anyway.
Actually, I just want to jump on one thing before you do that. Talking about there are decisions, choices to be made, and there are emotional choices, I just want to point out that in neuroscience today, it is an accepted fact, and has been for quite some time, that it is impossible for a healthy human being to make a decision that doesn't have an emotional component. That doesn't mean that you have a very emotional feeling about everything you do. In fact, I know Antonio Damasio would tell me I shouldn't use emotional feeling together at all, because feelings are the overall blanket, you know, the way you are, and emotion is the one thing at a time, the reactions. But in other words, every decision has an emotional quality to it. Even when you're making a choice that seems inevitable or that seems the result of what you've done, you don't have to do that. You have to want to do that. And if you don't want to do that, you do something else. So every choice is somewhat emotional. Of course, there are degrees of this, and the degrees can be usually heard.
Which I think is, it actually brings well into what I was going to say about this question of the intellect versus the mathematics. You know, the mathematics has been around for a very long time. Right, Pythagoras was writing about music and tones.
If he existed.
but that's been around, and it's changed, and the things that we are most concerned with have changed over time. But there have been all sorts of, you know, talking about a golden section of a piece, and you know, what's the way to balance your music. But the emotions have been around the whole time, and I actually think that your question, rather than whether it's been something that's happened in different places at different times, I think it's within different times of a composer's life. I think most composers go through transitions of this. They go through times of more analytical writing, more emotional, intuitive writing, and I think it's something that's just a constant back and forth.
And then the other thing, and you can add to this, the other thing I need to mention here is that if you're writing in any system at all of music, then there is an inevitable result that has mathematical aspects, even if you're not interested in them. So for example, if you're writing in tonality, you can't write in a key without having mathematical with proportions and variations, and the whole system of tonality and its harmony is based on mathematical principles, which you don't have to think about at all if you're writing in tonality. They can just be sounds for you. If you think of the most basic guitar play, you get a chord with a bar here and you go straight up. These are all parallel structures. Well, who thinks of them that way? How many parallel structures do you play? I mean, nobody talks like that. And one other thing about over time, in the 14th century in Europe, music was extremely consciously derived from numerical, from proportions and prolongations. And there were all sorts of systems where how much time goes by, how many beats, versus when the notes fall together. What am I thinking? What's the name of this?
Italian cholera?
Yeah, Italian cholera, but what's the overriding word?
Isorhythm.
Isorhythm, thank you.
Yes, I learned it from him.
I know you learned it from me, but I know how old you are. Yeah, isorhythm, which is not isometric. That's just an exercise. This is music. Anyway, so that whole system is quite old. Do you want to add something to that?
Oh, just that now we have the luxury of living in an age where we have all of these different ways of writing music, and so you can have, you know, Messiaen writing new isorhythmic music in the 20th century, and you know, we can write Brahms in the 21st century. And
All right, and that was a very good question, which took us a very long time to answer. So I think we have room for one or two more questions.
One and a half.
Where?
Where
yes,
was?
Up there?
Right there.
Go, Glenn. You know, for a mathematician, this guy is fast.
Well, mine will be to ask, because I just have a brief observation on your meditation that of the importance of the necessity of emotions in decision making. The Russians, I think it is, have an excellent aphorism for that. Emotions are the muscles of reason.
That sounds very good. No?
I like that. That's
great. Motion is the muscles of reason. And another either comment or rebuttal? Or question? Another question?
Complaints?
I know some people can't wait to get to the wine and dairy products. Not another question. Well, there's somebody who's got his finger up, but I think he's talking to somebody else. Yeah, okay, that's just the guy. Okay, very good. All right, well, you know what? Thank you so much. We'll see you out there. It's a pleasure.
And, of course, we also hope to see you at the next Harmonic Series in March with Sam Zygmuntowicz. And we hope to see you at the Museum of Mathematics on 26th between 5th and Madison, the north end of Madison Square Park. And we hope to see you outside in just a couple minutes. Thank you so much for coming.